of living water, a fountain that never will run dry. It's an open heaven you're releasing, and we will never be denied. Come on, church, let's stir it up tonight. 'Cause we're stirring up deep, deep wells. We're stirring up deep, deep waters. We're gonna dance in the river. Dance in the river. 'Cause we're stirring up deep, deep wells. We're stirring up deep, deep waters. We're gonna jump in the river. Jump in the river. 'Cause deep cries out. To you, deep cries out to you, and we cry out to you, Jesus. Deep cries out to you, deep cries out to you, and we cry out to you, Jesus. Let's sing it. I've got a river. And I've got a river of living water, a fountain that never will run dry. It's an open heaven you're releasing, and we will never be denied. Come on, let's stir it up. 'Cause we're stirring up deep, deep wells. We're stirring up deep, deep waters. We're gonna dance in the river. Dance in the river. 'Cause we're stirring up deep, deep wells. We're stirring up deep, deep waters. We're gonna jump in the river. Jump in the river. 'Cause deep cries out to deep cries out. Deep cries out to you, and we cry out to you, Jesus. Deep cries out to you, and deep cries out to you, and we cry out to you, Jesus. We're falling into deeper waters, calling. We cry out to you, Jesus. Through you the blind will see. Through you the mute will sing. Through you the dead will rise. Through you all hearts will praise. Through you the darkness flees. Through you my heart screams, I am free. Do you believe it? Let's sing it. And I am free to run.
And I am free to run.
And I am free to dance.
And I am free to live.
And I am free to live for you.
And I am free to live for you.
I am free.
I am free.
Through you the kingdom comes. Through you the battle's won. Through you I'm not afraid. Through you the price is paid. Through you there's victory. Because of you my heart screams, I am free. We are free indeed. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Come on, let's just sing it again. Worthy. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. So worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. And we sing, holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Jesus, Jesus, oh. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. So worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. We sing, holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes. open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up.
I'm so excited to be with you this evening. I trust that you are ready for an awesome, awesome time. So let's just pray as you come online. Father, we pray right now that you're going to move by your Spirit in our lives. Lord, that you're going to bring us to the place of destiny and purpose. But God, I pray most of all, Lord, that you are going to minister to us tonight. And Lord, that we will learn what we need to learn. But God, I pray that we'll have a revelation of what you have done for us and what you are currently doing. Father, I pray your blessing upon each and everyone in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen and amen. Well, folks, I want to bless you this evening. I just want to tell you, it's been a wonderful, wonderful journey with the Lord. And as I have walked these many years with God, I tell you what, I've seen some of the most incredible things take place. And so this evening, but before I get to the teaching, I want to teach tonight on angels and the power of angels and how they operate and what they do. But I want to say this. Father's Heart, I want to commend you, all right, for standing together and praying and being there. Okay, I think that God is busy with Father's Heart Digital Church. And I believe that God is going to do mighty things through the members still in years to come. I believe that as you submit under this flow, remember this, one of the biggest things about a local church is this. Whichever church you're under that anointing. Okay, you can operate under that anointing. And that's really important that you understand that. So don't think, you know, many people, and I'll help you with this. Many people think that if they cause a church split, that it's going to work. Church splits don't work. Why? Because the people are connected to the anointing of the house, the original house. Now, and I've seen this many times. Even when the people move, the anointing changes. The whole thing changes. And people go, but I don't want to be part of that. I want to be part of what was the original. And so please don't misunderstand what happens with churches and their local anointings that they carry. And so if you are part of Father's Heart, you carry the same anointing that we do. You can operate in it. But don't think that it's yours. Understand that it's the house's. And as long as you are in the house, you can operate in it. Okay? And so this is really important because even if you're just a member somewhere, you can carry the anointing of what is on Father's Heart. And you can continue to do that. Now, each church has got a specific assignment. Each local church. They got different giftings, different anointings. And so it's important that you understand that. But If you don't have a local church, I want to encourage you to consider joining Father's Heart. All right, all you do is you go to fathersheart.co.za and fill in an application form there. I wanted to say, the minute you're filled in an application form, we as the leaders immediately take responsibility for you. All right, we're praying for you, we're taking care for you, of you. And I want to just say, many have asked us, how do we operate if we're all over the country? All right, we operate in small groups all over the nation. But if you need us, it's as simple as one email and you can get a direct contact with any of the leaders. All right, go send an email to believers at Father's Heart. I have somebody who mans that email 24/7 and make sure that you can get the help that you need. Do we marry people? Do we ferry people? Yes, we do all of those things. Okay, so we will make sure we get to you. So please do not think that because we are scattered all over the nation, it's just what God wanted us to do in this season. And so this is what we are doing and this is what we are called to do. Okay, and this is what we are there for, so that we can create a spiritual umbrella over this nation. And so I want to commend each and every member that's part of this. Amen. So thank you for being faithful. Thank you for operating. Thank you for doing what God called you to do. Amen. All right, let's get into tonight's teaching. Tonight I want to deal with the topic entitled Power of Angels. The Power of Angels. Let's start off Joshua. Joshua ends up meeting Michael. In Joshua chapter 5, 13 to 15, it says this, and it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, a man stood opposite him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went to him and said, are you for us or are you our adversary? And then he said, no, but as the commander of the army of the Lord, I have now come. And Joshua fell at his face on the earth and worshipped at him at his feet and said, what does my Lord say to his servant? Then the commander of the Lord's army said to Joshua, take your sandals off your foot. The place that you're standing on is holy. And Joshua did this. Now, I want you to understand that even in the Old Testament, all right, we know that there are three archangels. Okay, there were three main archangels. There was Michael, who is a warring angel. There was Gabriel, a messenger angel. And then there was Lucifer, who was the worshiping angel. Okay? And so Lucifer fell, and Satan fell. And so he doesn't count in the archangels anymore. Obviously, he got taken out. So we have two archangels that are currently operating that we know of in the Word. Now, in some other writings, there's some others than that, but I don't want to include any of that because it's not in the Bible. All right, I'm just sticking to what's in the Bible right now. Now, it is important that we understand that angels have physical bodies, just like you and I. All right, they're not some spooky thing floating around somewhere. The Bible says that you will entertain angels and not even know them, that you'd entertain them. In other words, they look just like human beings. Now, some people have seen some of these archangels, and they are massive, all right? Others have seen angels, and they're just like the same size as us. And not every angel has wings. Okay, so please don't. There are angels that have wings, and the Bible clearly describes them, the seraphim and the cherubim, and these that have wings, all right? But the Bible's very clear that there are angels that look like human beings. If I saw somebody with the wings or something strange, I would then identify it as an angel and I'd say, but then I'd know that I was in the company of an angel. Now, even here, Joshua looks at this guy and he looks like a man because he says, listen, are you for us or against us? He didn't go, yes, you're a weird creature. You're abnormal. Okay? And this is very important that we understand this. Angels have physical bodies. Now, demons don't have physical bodies. Okay? Now, many people say that demons are fallen angels. No, that's not correct. All right? Demons are where in Genesis chapter 6, where the woman had sex with these angels, okay, and they created an offspring called the Nephilim. When those Nephilim died, they are not the half angel and half man. They are not human beings. And so they That's their spirits now float and roam the earth, and we call them demons. Okay. So I'm not going to get into that old teaching now, but I'm just giving you some background here. So I need you to understand, when we speak about angels, we are talking about somebody that cannot be seen. All right? I believe that angels live in a realm that cannot be seen, but they are around us all the time. And they move and they operate around us extensively. Okay, so this is so exciting because the Bible says, firstly, that, and we've got to know that we are operating on this level, that you have angels assigned to you. Psalm 34 verse 7 says this, and the angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear him and delivers them. Do you fear God? Are you born again? If you fear the Lord, you have an angel encamping around you. In other words, moving around you all the time. Now, I've had it, and I have not personally seen angels, but I've been in meetings or been in people's presence where they've actually seen my angels. They physically have seen the angel standing with me. All right? And the angel that's assigned to me is very, very big. All right? And I'm not saying the others are smaller. I'm just saying this is what they saw with me. The others could be even bigger than mine. I mean, it's not an issue of the size. All right, but what I'm saying is it's just not my height. This angel's a lot bigger and taller and stronger than me and stands normally to my right-hand side. So I'm just saying that every one of us are assigned angels. You know, sometimes we joke and we say, well, our guardian angels work overtime. But we've got to understand that these angels are there for an assignment. They are there for a purpose. Now, why would God give us angels if we're born again? Because you have the word of the Lord, you have the, you know, all of these things around us, the word, the Holy Spirit, tongues, prophecy, all these weapons that God has given us. So why do I still need an angel? I believe it's a very simple thing, because we fight in a realm that we cannot see. So very often you're not even aware of something that's coming up against you. Now, I believe that if we do this thing correctly, that your angels fight things off, even with you not even being aware that they were ever there. And this is very important, that we understand this and understand how angels operate and what God wants to do with us. Okay? Hebrews chapter 1:14, it says this, are they not all ministering spirits or angels sent forth to minister to those who will inherit salvation? So your angels come and they inherit, they come and minister to you if you're born again. So if you're a Christian, you have an angel that is there ministering to you without you knowing it. Now, what kind of ministry does an angel do? The angel does not come and minister in the sense of come and teach you something. All right? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that angels will teach me anything. Ministry means when I practically do something to you. And let me give you an example. If I come and I want to minister healing to you, I lay hands on you, I'm practically doing something, okay? I'm ministering to you, all right? If I'm going to help you with something, I will teach you something that's ministering to you, okay? So what do angels do for me? The angels protect and fight for me. They are ministering for me, right? They're ministering to me. In other words, they are protecting me. They are doing a job. But they are not going to make Jesus Christ more real to me. They are not going to teach me about what's going on in heaven. That is the Holy Spirit's job, and only the Holy Spirit's job. So if you hear people that get these heavy revies from angels and that, be skeptical. Right? Because the Bible does not say that angels are going to come and teach us these revelations. Because that's not their assignment. Their assignment is to fight on your behalf, to straighten the rough paths, to clear the spiritual atmosphere in front of you, and to make sure that you are protected spiritually. In Acts chapter 12, verse 15, we read, but they said to her, you are beside yourselves. Yet she kept insisting that it was so. So they said, it was his angel. Remember when they spoke about Jesus? Okay, and they said, listen, it's impossible for Jesus to have risen. You must have seen his angel. Now, it's interesting in the book of Acts that these guys are quite common and quite okay with the idea of seeing angels. And they understood it. They understood that you were assigned an angel. And here's one of the situations where they're busy discussing it. They said, look, it's impossible for that to have been the person. You must have just seen the angel. All right, the one that was actually fighting on their behalf. So, in Psalm 91, verse 9 to 12, it says this. Because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place, no evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. For he will give his angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. In other words, to protect you in everything that you are busy doing. And in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. That's the angels that are there to help you fulfill what God has called you to do. So, I want you to get this picture, all right? Just to help us visualize this. It is like you are moving, all right? Have you ever seen these VIPs? The president moves and he's got all his secret agents running around him, okay? Oh, that is the same picture that happens with angels. I need you to understand that as you move, you've got this army of angels around you ready to do things. And so the primary function and main purpose is to fight for you. Their primary function is to protect you spiritually. Because if you see something in the natural, you can help fight it off. You know what you're fighting. In the spirit, you don't have a clue what's going on. Now, I want us to go and have a look at this thing of where angels fight for us. All right? And remember this. This is their main primary function. They are not there to teach you. They're not there to guide you. They're not there to give you any other direction other than to make sure that you are protected and that you are safe. In 2 Kings chapter 19, verse 35, it says this. And it came to pass on a certain night that the angel of the Lord went out and killed in the camp of the Assyrians 185,000 people. And when the people arose in early in the morning, there were only corpses, because they were all dead. You see, yeah, we see in the Old Testament that the angel physically went to go and fight the enemies. The angel went to go and fight and kill people. Daniel chapter 6, 22, it says this. My God sent his angel and shut the lion's mouths. Do you remember the story of Daniel in the lion's mouth? Lion's pit? And so that they did, so that they would not hurt me. Okay? So I want you to see, God sent an angel, Daniel's angel, to close the mouths of the lions. So that they would not hurt him, because God had a plan for him and he was under God's protection. And then we also see in Acts chapter 5, verse 19. And at night, okay, now Peter's in prison. Now he does this often. He ends up in prison quite often. But he was in prison once again. Angel of the Lord opened the prison doors and brought them out. So the angel of the Lord got them out of prison, physically got them out of prison. Acts 12, 7. Now behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him. In the light shone in the prison, and he struck Peter on the side and woke him up, saying, arise quickly, and all the chains just fell off him. So I want you to understand that angels have a means to override the natural as well. They have a certain level of power, and they have a certain level of authority that they can operate on this earth. So we see that prison doors and chains and that doesn't restrict them. That's no problem for them. And so these angels are practically assigned to help you fulfill your task. Now, this is so important. If God has called you to do something, I need you to understand that you've also been assigned a protective detail to protect you, to make sure you can fulfill your thing. Now, this is why it is so important that you, number one, stick in your lane. Remember this. Angels only stick to what they've been assigned to do. They are not going to step out of line. But if you step out of line and go do something that you shouldn't be doing, And I don't just mean sin. I'm talking about if God has called you, let's say, to be a teacher and you decide, I don't want to do this. I want to be a plumber. And you decide to go against God's call. I want to tell you right now, those angels are not operating on your behalf anymore. You have left your security. All right. And the group of guys protecting you. And so you have decided to leave them. But they will continue protecting you and working with you and for you as long as you are doing what God called you to do. And this is why it's so important that we do what God calls us to do. You hear me? Day in and day out, we will minister this over and over and over again. And I think that this is so, so important that we get this. Right, but here comes the big one. You've been given this assignment of angels and guardian angels that are there to help you. But they only move on one condition. And what is that? They only move when you speak the word. They are not activated at all when you do not pray and do not speak the word. Psalm 103:20. The most important key to activating angels is this verse. Bless the Lord, you his angels, who excel in his strength, who do his word, heeding to the voice of his word. Not to the voice of Arthur, not to the voice of anybody else, only the voice of God's word. When I speak scripture, when I speak the Bible, the angels start moving because of the word of God that has been spoken. And so we've got to understand that we've got to do two things. Number one, you have got to stay in your lane. Stay in what God called you to do. And number two, you have got to release the word. When you release the word, the power of God is there. And God is going to honor that. And angels are going to move on your behalf. And so this evening I want to ask you, do you know that you've been assigned, all right, a squad of angels to protect you? Do you know that those angels are there to help you fulfill what God called you to do? Do you know that God wants those angels to move every time you speak scripture? So saints, are your angels moving, or are they still waiting for command? Let's pray. Father, we come before you this evening. We thank you, Lord, for your word. And Lord, I pray right now that we will not be the same again in Jesus' name. I pray that we will understand the revelation of what it is to have angels working and ministering on our behalf. Father, I pray right now that we will move and go and do what you've called us to do. Father, I pray right now that you'll forgive us where we go out of our calling and purpose. But Lord, that we will stay in what you called us to do. And Lord, we will see the blessing. We will see the power and we will see the glory be manifest in everything that we do. We thank you for this in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, amen and amen. Well, saints, I want to bless you. I want to say have a wonderful week. But remember, keep your focus on your angels, okay? God bless you. Love you lots. Bye-bye.